Good evening and thanks for coming. Welcome to the concert. For those of you watching over the internet, thanks for joining. My name is Neil Hampton. I'm the director of the Brandeis Wellesley Orchestra, and it's our great pleasure to present this concert. This concert is all about our wonderful students, our talented concerto winners, and we have a fantastic Mozart piano concerto, late piano concerto in a minor key, which is a bit unusual, and it's dark and turgid in a way of music that he would write later in Don Giovanni, where the Don Giovanni is consumed in flame. So there's a great sort of dark intensity and a romantic sensibility to this concerto. The second concerto is a Koussevitzky bass concerto, and Koussevitzky was known here in Boston as the conductor of the Boston Symphony from about 1924 to 1945 or 46 or 51. He died in 51. And among his proteges and students were Leonard Bernstein, and he was also a bass soloist, and he wrote this this concerto. Of course, three, we're going to be playing the second and third movements of it. And then also we have the last movement of the Tchaikovsky's iconic violin concerto, and it's just a firecracker of a movement. You're going to love it. And before we play that, we're going to start with a piece called The Bambula by Samuel Coleridge Taylor. He was an English composer, born in England to an English mother and a father from Sierra Leone. And at 15, he entered the Royal Conservatory and quickly distinguished himself, and Edward Elgar noted that he was the smartest one of the lot. And he began writing, and he encountered the music of Dvorak and fell in love with Dvorak. And Dvorak at the time was supporting the idea of bringing folk music having composers use folk music as inspiration for the music of their own countries. Dvorak was Czech, so he used Czech music in his the Czech dances in his music. Brahms used Hungarian dances to bring that flavor and energy. Grieg brought Norwegian melodies into his music. And Dvorak came to America in 1901 and was the head of a conservatory, and he was encouraging American composers to explore African-American spirituals and folk music and bring that into their music. And Samuel Coleridge Taylor, an English African composer, started to explore this. So, The Bambula is based on a fragment of a Caribbean tune. A bambula is also a drum, an African drum, and it was brought here from Africa by the enslaved people. But it's built on four bars, which we're going to play for you now. So, that's the inspiration, and everything else you're going to hear now is things that he constructed around it. And in the hallmark of a great composer, and I believe this gentleman is a great composer, everything is woven from this, from these ideas. It's tightly structured, and then he turns it into this wonderful three-part piece where it's fast, slow, fast, but everything is drawn from what you just heard. So we hope that you enjoy this. We love playing it. It's The Bambula, a symphonic rhapsody by Samuel Coleridge Taylor.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
It's just sometimes overwhelming when you encounter so much talent, you know, and you get a chance to be around all these wonderful students. And now a couple of them are rejoining the orchestra to assume their leadership roles here, which has just been a delight. Our next piece is the Carnival Overture by Antonín Dvořák, Czech composer that inspired the first piece, the Samuel Coleridge-Taylor. And this is one of, originally conceived of one of three overtures. Sort of like a tone poem in an extended form. It was a triptych of concert overtures intended to portray impressions of what a human soul might experience, both in positive and negative aspects. And it was sort of nature, life, and love, 1, 2, 3. And this was the second one, which was about life. And then he retitled it Life Carnival. So, you know, this is all about boisterous life and crowds and, you know, high-spirited tumult. In a festive carnival setting. And then there's a slow section in the middle, which he described, which he said was a pair of straying lovers. So we have a contrast in the middle. Again, that fast, slow, fast kind of form that you heard first in the Bambula. So we very much hope you enjoy the Carnival Overture, Antonín Dvořák.
Thank you.
So every spring concert, it's a little bit of a sadness to have to recognize the seniors and wish them happy life past our orchestra experience. So I'd like to have all the graduating seniors in the orchestra please rise to stand. You know, the presence of these wonderful young people here is a testament to the parents who, throughout their childhood, drove many, many miles and gave many, many lessons in order for them to be able to have the technique and the experience to be able to join together and play this kind of advanced repertory. So I'm deeply grateful to all of the sacrifices from all of you out there, maybe watching from home. Thank you. I know that it's this will carry in their lives and be an important part of making it a better life. Next year is the 20th anniversary of the Brandeis Wellesley Orchestra. We first had our first concert here in 2003 together. And we're going to be celebrating with an extra special year with a performance next November of Beethoven's Ninth Symphony here with wonderful soloists and the combined choirs of Brandeis, Wellesley, and the Worcester Polytechnic Institute. There'll probably be 200 voices here on stage with us for this magnificent piece. And there will also be a wonderful fanfare by Adolphus Hailstork, who is a great name. If you don't know him, you should. He's a wonderful composer. So I was looking for something that might be sort of a long tease towards the November concert. And I found through a friend of mine composed or made an arrangement of music from the last movement of the Ninth Symphony. A man named Stephen Kouridianos, he's the director of the Plymouth Philharmonic, and he had written this for that orchestra for an all Beethoven program. And I just want to read you his program notes here. There are many instrumental versions of Beethoven's uplifting Ode to Joy melody for orchestra, yet none I could find that were true to the original version penned by the composer. I took it upon myself to fill that void. Every note of the prelude, Ode to Joy, is Beethoven conceived and arranged by yours truly, his truly. For the most part, this prelude includes every non-vocal statement of the Ode to Joy melody from the fourth movement of the Ninth Symphony as scored for orchestra by Beethoven. I say for the most part because I just couldn't help myself. As a grand finale, I include the grand choral statement of the melody in this prelude. Since we don't have a chorus tonight, I scored the chorus parts for the instruments not playing that section of the music. Piccolo, both clarinets, and three trombones, just to give it some extra oomph. I reassigned the lead trumpet to that famous melody too. I hope the spirit of dear Ludwig forgives me. This all comes from a place of reverence and love. That's Stephen Kouridianos' words. So thank you again for coming to hear us tonight. I hope you'll join us for the Beethoven in the fall. Here is the prelude, Ode to Joy.